You're a child, and you're in here today. I got some sermon notes for you, so if you would like those sermon notes, anybody would like those. Maybe Taylor, could you maybe pass these out? Maybe you guys could raise your hand, and Taylor will hand those out to you, and she might need some help here. There you go. Yeah, Brantley, you can grab the pencils. And if you want those kiddos, you just raise your hand, and they'll get those to you, and you can take some sermon notes. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today, and we are in the season of Lent, and we're making our way towards Resurrection Sunday, looking forward to the celebration of Jesus' victory over sin and death. But there was a journey to that place, and so now we are focusing in on that journey. And so last week we spoke on Palm Sunday, about Palm Sunday, and Jesus riding in to Jerusalem and on a donkey, which would have been a somewhat of a political statement in a sense that people would have recognized that those who have done that in the past were people like King David or King Solomon. Notice there, the king in front of both of these people, right? That Jesus is doing this as king, and that he was coming into Jerusalem as the king. And it says that when he first gets to Jerusalem, when he sees it there, that he weeps. And he weeps because he knows that this that Jerusalem will eventually fall, that they did not recognize the coming of the true king. And the same people that are shouting Hosanna and praises to Jesus will soon be shouting crucify him. But that was Sunday, and so today we're going to be talking about Monday and what Jesus did on Monday as he entered into the temple. And so let's read from Matthew chapter 21, verse 12. Starting in verse 12. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to Jesus at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting into the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, Jesus replied. Have you never read? From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise. And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. So all this is taking place there in Jerusalem in the temple courts. This is actually a model of what the temple looked like during Jesus's day. The king at the time had actually expanded this to where it was about a 35-acre plot of land there. So this is ginormous, right? And people would have, when Jesus was coming in on the donkey, when it says that he overlooked Jerusalem, this would have been towering over. He would have seen the temple, right? And we remember that the temple is God's hotspot, right? That the Israelites understood that the temple was where the physical presence of God overlapped with earth. That God's physical dwelling was in the temple. And that this was a place where the sacrifices were made to make the people right with God and to the place of worship, where they would worship God. And it's the focal point of the Israelite community, right? This is the place to be. And Jesus is coming in, and sacrifices have to be made, and it says that he entered into the temple courts. And so most likely, the area that would have been is probably in one of these areas, and this would have been open to Gentiles as well, as they could make their way into this area. As you get closer and closer into the temple, though, it gets more and more secluded to where fewer and fewer people could go in until you get to the Holy of Holies, which would have only been for the high priest once a year. And so this time is coming where they're about to celebrate Passover. And so there really is a big boom of people coming in. It's like Branson during Christmas, right? Everybody is making their journey to Branson, right? To go see the shows and see Silver Dollar City and all these things. You have to be there, right? And all these people are coming in. And Jerusalem usually would have fit, from the estimations that I've read, like 50,000 people. But there might have been up to 100 to 150,000 people, right? It's just booked, packed. It's an insane amount of people that are coming in. And so Jesus comes into the temple courts. He's in this area here. And it says, Jesus entered into the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. So he goes in. He sees the people exchanging money, which isn't abnormal. He saw the sacrificial animals there, which is not abnormal. But he sees that this has become a place of great corruption, right? So there was a temple tax that the Israelites would have to pay. Every man, it tells us in the book of Exodus, when they came in once a year, they had to pay half a shekel, right, of the temple tax. So if you, you know, have 150,000 people there, you know, how many shekels is that? Fred, you're a mathematician. Thank you. 75,000, yes. I was homeschooled. No, I actually knew the answer. I was just testing you all. 75,000, right? That's a pretty penny worth, right? But what was happening was the currency of the time had images of people on there. So you like we have today, you know, we have the quarter, it has George Washington on there. But if you look in the Old Testament law, right, we are not to have any image of those who are to be gods, right? And the people saw their leaders as a sort of god. And so they would convert this temple coin they would convert the coins that they were bringing in into a different coin that had no images on it, right? It was the temple coinage. But if you're gonna do that, you know, you might wanna make a little bit of money while you're converting the coinage, right? And so I've read estimates up to 8% to all the way to 15% of an exchange rate, right? So you do that times 150,000 people, you're making some good money, right? Right off the bat. And then, of course, you have to have your animal sacrifices. And this wasn't a deal of people being corrupt in a sense that they were selling the animals, because God did require these animals. Right, but if you are upping the prices, you're taking advantage of people, knowing that all these people are going to come in, knowing that you have to have the right animal, then it was very, very corrupt institution. And it says that Jesus overturns the tables of the money changers, and it says, and the benches of those who are selling doves. And it's interesting, those are the ones that he overturns, so the ones who are making a corrupt amount of profit, and then the ones who are selling doves. Well, we know from Leviticus, when you guys read that this week, right, the book of Leviticus, I know you're all reading Leviticus, right? No? No? Uh-huh. Okay. Well, in Leviticus, right, every once in a while you find your nuggets. Leviticus 12:8, it talks about if you do not have enough money, right, for a lamb, if you cannot sacrifice a lamb, which would have been a great value if you're poor, right, you can sacrifice a dove or a pigeon, right? You can give these bird offerings instead, and the Lord would accept those, right? And when Jesus actually goes into the temple when he's a child, that is the sacrifice that Mary gives, right? Because they were not wealthy. They were very poor. And so Jesus has a passion, a zeal, and he sees that people are being taken advantage of, right? And he has this zeal even more so towards the poor, right? That he goes after those who already are down low in the society, and he is zealous for them, and he overturns the tables. And he says, "It is written," he said to them, "my house will be called a house of prayer." Sorry, prayer. And this is referring to Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7. And actually what it says there is a prayer, a house of prayer to the nations, right? Remember that Israel is God's chosen people, that God chose Abraham of all the people, right? That God's chosen this nation of all the people to be their representatives to the world so that what? So that they can be better than everybody else? No, so that they can show what God is like to the world and draw them in as well, right? And Jesus is saying this temple was to be a house of prayer, and it goes on in Isaiah to say, and they would have known this, a house of prayer to the nations, right? That we as a community are to be drawing people in. That this temple place is not for us, the elite, as the Israelites, God's chosen people, but this place is to draw those in from all corners of the earth that they might know who our God is. And as we go back to that picture, you can see that that area would have been for who? The Gentiles. They couldn't get any closer than that. And what is taking place there in the Gentile court? Is it prayer? That the Gentiles may be in there and praying. No, now it's been stuffed with animals. It's been stuffed with people buying and selling and making huge profits. And there's no prayer of the Gentiles going on there because they've been kind of shoved out, right? This place that is supposed to be for all people has become a place of trade and commerce, right? And so Jesus, he is upset by this. He says, but you are making it into a den of robbers. In Jeremiah 7, 8 through 11, it talks about what was going on during the religious time of that time. And the same thing, where they're not giving to the Lord what was due them, that there is corruption. But they keep on saying, but we have the temple of the Lord. We have the temple of the Lord. We have the temple of the Lord. But they do whatever they want to. They act however they want to. They don't follow God, but they were using the temple as a way of status, of saying, we can do whatever we want, basically, is how they lived their life. But then when it came to, you know, do you know God? Oh, yeah, we got the temple, right? It's the presence of God, right? And how often do we do that, maybe? That we live our life however we want to, right? We're not living in a way of integrity. We're not following after the God. But we might hold up, well, I was saved when I was a child. I was saved when I was a child. I was saved when I was a child. I went to BBA. Well, I go to church. Well, I go to church, right? And Jesus is saying, you can make your sacrifices. You can do all that stuff. But if you're not following after God, this place is nothing but a den of robbers. And when Jesus goes in and he overturns the tables, right, we see this holy zeal that Jesus has. And he goes and he overturns the tables and he turns over the benches of the pigeons. And what Jesus is doing here is a prophetic act. He is acting as a prophet. If you go to Isaiah 20, what we see of our prophets is sometimes they do some crazy things, right, in order to get a message that God has given them, right, a point across, right? So in Isaiah 20, one example of this is, Isaiah's like, you need to take off your clothes, right? And you're going to walk around naked for 3 years, right? Who would like to be that prophet? Anybody? No, right? How embarrassing, right? And he was saying, you are going to show the humiliation that you guys are going to go through when you go into exile. And you are going to give that warning. So for 3 years, this guy's walking around. You guys need to change your ways, right? And Nothing. And they do, there's different ways in which they do this, right? And what Jesus is doing here is a prophetic act as well. He's overturning these tables. He's throwing the benches around. Things are going everywhere, right? He's making a scene. And what would have happened is, you know, you got the system down pretty good tight because you have 150,000 people online, right? So you have to make them sacrifices and go, right? That means you got to exchange your money here. You got to get your animal here. You're going to sacrifice here, right? And we got to keep this thing rolling. Well, if you got your money exchanged at the beginning, right, what's going to happen to the thing? There's going to be a pileup, right? Business is shut down for a little while. And what Jesus is doing here is saying that, because he goes on in Mark chapter 13, and he's saying one day this temple is going to be destroyed. And in chapter 19, we talked about that last week, he weeps, he says, because one day this place is going to be overthrown, right? And in that moment, he is showing that this is going to take place not too long from here. And that building that we showed, the 35-acre temple court area, it took them, I think they said, 20 AD to 63 AD, right? So 43 years for them to build that place. And then Jesus is given all this warning. Guess when it gets destroyed? 70 AD. It was completed in 63. It was good for 7 years. And then Rome came and just completely destroyed it. And there was no stone left unturned, it says. They completely destroyed it. And what Jesus is doing is showing that these sacrificial systems are going to stop taking place. And then this Bible scholar, N.T. Wright, says this: Jesus is the reality to which the temple points to. So the time is where Jesus has stopped production, in a sense, right? The sacrifices are not taking place. The sacrifices are to make God and man right with each other once again. And it is the place in which God's presence physically dwells, right? Where does God's presence physically dwell now that Jesus is on the scene? Within Jesus. He is the sacrifice of which all these other sacrifices are pointing to, right? But the people are so focused on the sign that they don't see the reality to which it's pointing to, which is Jesus, right? My dog is not the smartest dog in the world, right? And every once in a while, I'm trying to communicate with this thing, right? And it's hard. I'm like, Dudley, go over there, right? And I point, and this is the reality to which I want him to see. It might be his food. It might be who knows what it is, right? The mess he made, and I want him to know I don't like it, right? Look at that. And what does he do? He looks at my hand. He thinks maybe I have a treat in there, right? What I'm doing is pointing to the reality of what I want him to see, but he's focused on what? My hand, that it's pointing to. And the people are so focused on the temple and what this place is supposed to be that they don't see that the temple is pointing to the reality, which is Jesus. Does that make sense? And they are missing it. And so they get upset because they're upset that Jesus is talking about the pointer, and he's saying, I am the reality to which this is pointing to. And so this upsets people, which is, you know, which makes sense. Because it's no accident that Jesus dies this week. So the story goes on. It says, the blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of God of David, they were indignant. Right? And so instead of seeing, wow, this place is to be a place of worship, this place is to be a place of healing to the nations, right? They see God acting and working, and they're seeing the reality of God's kingdom taking place. But the Pharisees and the Sadducees are upset because it's messing, getting this all messed up, right? He's showing that this isn't as that this is the pointer, not the reality. And they take offense to what Jesus is doing because it hurts not only their profits, but it also hurts their status. Because if you're working your whole life maintaining this, right, and this is how you make your money, you think they're going to like the reality so much that it's pointing to? Are you guys following me? They are upset. And they are blinded by their sin and their corruption. And it's so interesting. The blind are coming to see, but the Pharisees, who are supposed to know God, who are supposed to be worshiping God, who are supposed to be having these outbreaks of the kingdom of God within them, can't see that the reality is there amongst them. They do not see that Jesus is doing what they were supposed to be pointing towards this whole time. Instead, they are blinded by their sin. And friends, our sin blinds us. You know, sometimes I think we can think, I don't see God working in my life. I don't know if... And sometimes God is quiet and you can be following after God and it feels very silent. And I've gone through those times in my life, so I'm not saying that. But also, on the other hand, there are times in our life where it's like, man, I can't see what God's doing. I can't hear him. And it's like, well, look at the way you're living, right? All you do is what you want to do. You haven't changed your heart. You haven't repented. You haven't worked at all to give it to God. And you're surprised that you can't hear from the Lord, even though you're going your own way. You're not even on the same path that God desires for you. And you're shocked that you can't hear from him. You're shocked that you don't see him working in your life. You have to have God come and open your eyes. You have to repent and say, Lord, let me see the ways in which you're moving. And what do I need to repent from so that I can see? But the Pharisees, they continue in their blindness and they continue on. And they end up being the ones who put Jesus to the cross. I love this also, and this is a good message for us today. It says this in verse 14. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. This is after Jesus overturns the tables, and pigeons are flying everywhere. You know, you can imagine the chaos that's being taken place. And this has stopped the assembly line. And now what's taking place? Instead of the hustle and bustle, Jesus is standing there. And what's taking place? The blind are beginning to see. The lame are being healed. And the children see this with their eyes. And they worship, saying, Hosanna, right? To the Son of David. The kids get it, right? Kids, I believe that God speaks to you in a way that you can understand. I was 11 years old. Anybody here 11? Okay, there we go. Brantley, stand up, Brantley. Okay, Brantley, I was 11 years old when I felt the call of God to preach on my life, right? Brantley, I believe in my whole being that God can speak into you in a way that you understand, and you have to listen to him, okay? That goes for all you kids. You can sit down, right? But when I was 11 years old, I heard that. These kids, they see what Jesus does, and they recognize God's power. They recognize this. They're not looking at the temple. They're looking at the reality, right? And they're like, it's God right there. The kids recognize them, right? And it's a beautiful thing. And Jesus doesn't just cleanse the temple, he gets all the bad out. What does he do? He fills it with healing. And it is now filled with worship, what it was meant to be the whole time. So Jesus not only empties the temple, but he also fills it with healing and worship. And friends, let me tell you, we are a holiness church. We are a holiness church. And so we believe that Jesus not only saves us from our sins, right? We believe wholeheartedly that God has come and that he forgives us of our sins and that our heart is made clean. Amen? We believe that. And that is an amazing message. But as holiness people, we believe that God not only wants to empty our heart of sin, but he wants to fill it with his holy love. And so when Jesus is here in the temple, he doesn't just, you're doing it all wrong and then leave. He doesn't just empty it, but he fills it. He fills it with his healing, with his love, with worship. And friends, if you're just saying, well, I don't do this, I don't do that, I don't. Yeah, he saved us, but he wants us to live. He wants us to be filled with his Spirit. It's not just an emptying, but it's a filling. That this same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead, it tells us in Scripture, lives within us. And so, friends, if you've asked for forgiveness in your heart, that's awesome. Praise God. But there has to be a moment in our life also that God is drawing you to, that he wants to fill your heart, that he wants to fill you with his very presence. And you just have to say, God, fill me. I want all of you, which requires repentance and requires us to say, God, you can have all of me. I heard Dr. Graves say it like this, at the moment of our salvation, we have all of God. Right? He gives us all of his grace. He gives us all of our forgiveness. He gives us all of his mercy. We have all of him. And there comes this moment in our life where we are sanctified. It means set apart for God's purposes. And what he says is at salvation, God, we get all of God. At sanctification, God gets all of us. God, you can have all of me. And friends, what would it look like if Coffeyville First Church in the Nazarene was full of people that God had all of them? Man, I believe that there would be a revival in our town. Amen. Doesn't that kind of excite you? That we could be a part of that? What does it take? Surrender. God emptying out the things in our life that are not pleasing to him. You know, Lent, we think about these things of how do I need to repent? Is there anything in my life that needs to be over into the Lord? But then there's the infilling of the Holy Spirit. All this is leading up to Passover. And the day after Passover, there's a feast that the Jews would celebrate called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And that looks forward, or that goes back to the time in Exodus where the Israelites are becoming free. They get out of Egypt, but it's happening so fast, it says they didn't even have time for the bread to rise, and they just took the unleavened bread and they got out of there, right? Because if you put leaven in there, it has to rise, blah, 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 blah. And so they didn't have time for that, right? And so before the Feast of Unleavened Bread, they would take preparation time and they would sweep out and clean out anything that had leaven in it so there would be no leaven within the house. And leaven was also a symbol for people. And Jesus even said, you know, look out for the yeast of the Pharisees, right? It was a symbol sometimes of corruption, right? Because corruption spoils things. You think about your Wonder Bread that's in your cabinet right now. It's got the black mold in the back, right? You haven't looked at it in a while, right? It spoils. And it affects the whole thing, right? If you put a little leaven in it, it affects the whole thing. The whole thing rises, right? And so the leaven was also a way for people to think of, as they were cleaning out the leaven, is there anything in my heart, right, that is not pleasing? So all these people are cleaning out their homes, okay, of the leaven, of the yeast. They're cleaning it out in preparation for the day after Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, what is Jesus doing? He's cleaning out his house.
Jesus said, did you not know I have to be in my Father's house? Jesus is cleaning out the corruption that is taking place within his Father's home. He's cleaning it out, getting it prepared. Friends, we have to do the same thing within our hearts. And he doesn't want to just clean us. He wants to fill us. That can happen today. Sherry, would you come and play the piano? And we're going to have a time to respond. And everybody can stand. And if you feel like the Lord's speaking to you, you might say, you know, I've never asked the Lord to be Lord of my life. I've never given my life to him, but I want to, and I want to be saved from my sin. Today is a wonderful day to do that. You can come down to the altar, and we can pray with you. You might say, man, I've been following the Lord my whole life, but I feel like God is calling me to more than just an empty house, an empty heart of the things that I don't do. But man, I want to be filled with his presence. That when I interact with my wife or my spouse, right, that it is an infilling of the Holy Spirit that is just responding to them, to my family, to my coworkers, to my schoolmates, whatever it might be, that when people see me, that it's an outflow of the filling of the Holy Spirit, that they would see that within me. If you want to come to the point in your life where you say, man, I know that I have all of God, but I want God to have all of me. Today is the day, right, that you can be sanctified, set apart for God's purposes. But you have to be willing. You have to say, God, you can have me, right? And the Lord Jesus wants to do that in your life today. And I believe that it can change your heart today. And it's a continual act. It's not like a one and done, well, I got sanctified and now. No, it's yes, God did that, and he's continuing to do that. He's continuing to fill me up. Man, I need God's wisdom, his power, his mercy, his grace in my life every single day. If you want that, you can come to the altar, pray, and say, Lord, I need that in my life. Would you just fill me today? Would you fill me today? We're going to pray. If the Lord is speaking into your heart, if you would like any of this today, God wants to do it. God will do it. It says in Thessalonians that he is faithful and he will do it. Let's just go to the Lord and pray. If you like, come down to the altar and pray. Be sensitive to what the Lord is doing. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, that you would fill this church with your Holy Spirit. And God, that we would be attentive, Lord, to what you are doing in our lives, God. God, as we go through this season, Lord, I pray that you would just help us to clean our hearts, God. Is there anything in our lives that is corrupt? Anything that's eroding, God? And Lord, that you would just point that out to us, God, and that you would move within our hearts, God. We need you. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. And God, we thank you that you are the one who does this, Lord, that we can't do it on our own. We need you. So, Lord, we pray that you just bless us this week. And in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.